In this lecture, we are going to discuss about basic principle of solar cell. So first, let's see what is a solar cell. So we know that solar cell is a photovoltaic device that converts the light energy that is coming from the sun into the electrical energy. So we all know that solar cell is a photovoltaic device that converts the light energy into electrical energy. So in shortly we can say that this device works on the principle of photovoltaic effect. Effect or photovoltaic principle. So first let's see what is a photovoltaic effect. So it's necessary to understand first the what is a photovoltaic effect, and then we will try to understand the basic requirements for making a solar cell. So first, what is a photovoltaic effect? Or photovoltaic principle, whatever you want to say it. So in general, the photovoltaic effect means the generation of a potential difference at the junction of two different materials in response to visible or other radiations. So here we can simply say that let's say these are two dissimilar materials, that is, this is material A and this is material B, and this is their junction. So in photovoltaic effect, we can get a potential difference across this junction when we fall some light on this junction. So in response to the visible or other radiation, there is a potential difference between these two materials. So this is actually a photovoltaic effect, that is the generation of a potential difference between two dissimilar materials. So normally the photovoltaic effect is having the three basic steps, and so simply let's say this is our absorber that is made by material AB. So first there is a generation of charge carriers at this junction, then we have to separate out the charge carriers like electrons and holes from each other, and third we have to collect these charge carriers. So these three steps are very important in a photovoltaic effect, that is first generation of charge carriers due to absorption of photons at the junction. Number second, then separation of photo generated charge carriers in the junction. And subsequently, collection of the photo generated charge carriers at the terminals of the junction. So these are three basic steps that we can see in a photovoltaic effect, that is first generation of charge carriers due to absorption of light, then we have to separate out these photogenerated charge carriers, and third, we have to collect these charge carriers at the terminal of the device. So first, let's see what are the basic requirements to make a solar cell. So our first requirement is to have an absorbing material, that is, for making a solar cell, our first aim is, or requirement is, an absorber or absorbing layer or absorbing material or absorber, whatever you want to say it. So our first aim is an absorber layer in which the photons of incident radiation are efficiently, and please note this word, efficiently absorbed resulting in the creation of charge carriers, that is, electrons and hole pairs. So our first aim or first requirement is an absorber layer or absorber material. Now our second aim is our second aim is to separate the photogenerated electrons and holes from each other and this can be done by using some semi-permeable membrane. That can selectively allow only one type of charge carriers to pass through and block other type of carrier. And since I am writing semi-permeable membrane as SPM is allowing one type of carriers . Therefore, we have to attach two different kinds of SPM to both sides of the absorber. Meaning here is that first we have to use a absorber. Here I am not defining what is this absorber, but its property is to absorb the photons and convert these photons into electron and hole pairs. So now for separate out these electrons and holes, we have to use two SPM, that is semi-permeable membranes. That is one which can allow one type of carriers only, let's say electrons. So this is SPM one, and other, let's say it's SPM two. That is here, meaning is that this is our absorber layer where electrons and holes are generating due to absorbing of photons, and this SPM1 is only allowing electrons. So electron will go through this layer and holes will go through this layer. So after separate out these electrons and holes, we can again collect these electrons for further application. So these special semi-permeable membranes are very important for separating these photo-generated charge carriers. So our third requirement or aim is now an important issue after designing an efficient सोलर सेल इज दैट द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स एंड होल्स जनरेटेड इन द एब्जॉर्बर लेयर मस्ट बी रीज्ड टू द मेम्ब्रेन्स और SPM सेमी परमिएबल मेम्ब्रेन्स. सो हेयर वन इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग इज दैट लेट्स से हेयर मैनी इलेक्ट्रॉन एंड होल्स पेयर आर जनरेटेड बट इफ द थिकनेस ऑफ दिस एब्जॉर्बर लेयर इज लार्जर देन द डिफ्यूजन लेंथ ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स देन दे कांट रीच टू SPM 1 और SPM 2. सो वी हैव टू एडजस्ट द थिकनेस ऑफ दिस एब्जॉर्बर लेयर सच दैट ऑल द फोटो जनरेटेड चार्ज कैरियर्स कैन गो टू दिस SPM 1 और SPM 2. So therefore, the thickness of the absorber layer is smaller than the diffusion length of the charge carriers. So these are our three basic requirements for making a solar cell. That is, first we have to choose an absorber layer, then we have to make it so thick that all the photo generated charge carriers can go through this charge collection layer SPM 1 or SPM 2. So these are our basic requirements. Now we have to see what kind of material we can use for these semi-permeable membranes. That is, what kind of material can be used to separate electrons only, and what kind of material can be used to separate out holes only. So now let's me define these semi-permeable membranes, and this is very important step in understanding of the principle of solar cell. So semi-permeable membranes. So a membrane that let electrons to go through and blocks hole is a material which has a large conductivity for electrons and small conductivity of holes. So this is the first condition to get a semi-permeable membranes that can allow electrons only. So which material can allow electrons only? That has a high conductivity for electrons and a very low conductivity for holes. And we know that the n-type semiconductor is a perfect example of this type of SPM. So we can use an n-type material for this purpose that can allow only electrons. In which a large electron conductivity with respect to the hole conductivity is caused by a large difference in electron and hole concentration . So meaning is here is that we can use an n-type material that can allow only electrons and can block holes. And we know that electrons can easily flow through the n-type material or n-type semiconductor while the transport of holes is very limited due to the recombination process. and the opposite holds for electrons in a p-type semiconductor which is an example of the whole membrane. So here we can use an n-type semiconductor for electron membrane and p-type semiconductor for whole membrane. That is, a p-type semiconductor can allow only holes that can pass through it, and an n-type semiconductor can allow only electrons to pass through it. So now we know that n-type material can pass electrons through it, but we have to oppose the passing of the holes through it, or we have to restrict the holes to come near to this n-type semiconductor, and at the same time we have to restrict the electrons to go near to the p-type semiconductor. So now, in order to minimize the, this step is very important, minimize the injection of holes from the absorber into the n-type semiconductor, and energy barrier should be introduced in the valence band. Between the n-type semiconductor and the absorber, meaning here is that to restrict the holes to come near to the n-type material, we have to choose the n-type semiconductor in such a way that there is a energy difference between their valence band. Let's say this is the absorber layer, it's EV and EC. Now we have to choose this n-type semiconductor such that there is a energy difference between their valence band. That is, this is the energy band difference. And we know that holes behave like air bubbles. So they can go only in the upward direction. So if there are holes in this absorber layer, then if the valence band of the n-type semiconductor is below the valence band of this absorber layer, then it's not easy to go holes from this absorber layer to this n-type semiconductor. So we have to choose this n-type semiconductor such that, but at the same time their conduction band should be matched to each other so that electrons can easily go from absorber layer to n-type semiconductor. So we have to keep this in mind, and this can be achieved by choosing an n-type semiconductor that has a large band gap or larger band gap than that of the absorber, such that the energy difference is located in the valence band of two materials. So, as I discussed earlier, now let's say this is our absorber layer. Now we have to use a wide band gap material for n-type semiconductor that has a larger band gap, but there is a energy difference between valence band of these two. That is, this is our absorber. Now let me take a n-type semiconductor that has a energy difference so this is 4 convenient I am drawing it in this side. So this is our n-type semipermeable membrane, that is n-type semiconductor, and this is absorber. And this is the energy difference between the valence band. This is EV and this is also EV for absorber, and this is EC. This is EC. This is EC for n-type semiconductor. So this is the, let's say it's delta EV. So we have to use and for p-type semiconductor, similarly, we have to make a energy difference between the conduction band of this absorber and p-type material. So first let me write this. Similarly, the injection of electrons from the absorber into the p-type semiconductor could be suppressed by using a p-type semiconductor with a larger band gap than that of the absorber and having the band offset in the conduction band. We can write it delta EC as we use delta EV for n-type between the absorber and the p-type semiconductor . It simply means that the electrons that the electron affinity that is Ji E of the p-type semiconductor is smaller than the smaller than that of the absorber. So simply, we know that if there are two materials such that their energy bands are like this. Now we know that electrons can go in upward direction only. That is, electrons behave like some solid ball or water. That is, they can go from higher level to lower level. But they can't move in the upward direction without any external help. So if we take this is EC and this is EV for first material, and this is EC and EV for second material, electrons can only move from this side to this side, but electrons can't move from this side to this side because there is a energy difference between the minimum of the conduction band of these materials. If these electrons want to move from this side to this side, then we have to apply some external field, or we have to apply some external force so that these electrons can get sufficient energy to move from this side to this side. So we have to choose the band gap of the p-type semiconductor in such a way that electrons can't move from absorber layer to p-type material. So for this we can use a p-type material such that their conduction band, minimum of the conduction band EC, is higher in energy than the EC of the absorber layer. So this is the, let me write neatly, so this is our n-type material. And if we draw a vacuum levelets here, this is evac, evac, then we know that this is EC for p-type material, this is electron affinity for this material, and this is the electron affinity for this absorber layer, and this is also the electron affinity of this n-type material. So here at equilibrium, let's say Fermi levels for these are like this. So this is p-type material. This is p-type semiconductor, this is n-type semiconductor, and this is absorber. So we have to choose these semi-permeable membranes in such a way that for this n-type semiconductor, electrons can move from absorber layer to this layer, and at the same time this membrane is acting in such a way that it can oppose the movement of the holes towards itself. And similarly, in for p-type semiconductor, it can help in attracting the holes towards itself, since we can see here that holes can easily move from this side to this side because maximum of the valence band for both of these materials are at equal level. So holes can easily move to in this side, but electrons cannot move from absorber to this p-type material or p-type semiconductor, since there is a energy difference between the minimum of the conduction band of these two. That is this is delta EC. And one more important things of choosing of this wide band gap membrane is that since these membranes are having wider band gap, so all the radiation falling on these membranes can easily pass through this absorber layer, so that we can get more charge carriers in this absorbing layer. So we can write here that this is another important things for wider band gap material that can be used for membrane that the membranes with wider band gap are also helpful in allowing almost all photons to be transmitted and absorbed into the absorber. So now let's, this is in equilibrium condition. Equilibrium condition. Now let's see what is going to happen when we incident some radiation on this cell. Then let me first copy of this whole image. So now let's incident some light on this solar cell. So now I am removing so when we incident radiation on it or light on it, we know that electrons and holes are generated in this absorbing or layer or absorber layer, and we used this n-type semiconductor in such a way that electrons will move towards this side and holes will move towards this side. Since electrons are going to this side, so Fermi level in this side is going in upward direction. So electrons Fermi level in this n-type semiconductor will go in upward direction, and at the same time the Fermi level in the p-type semiconductor is going downward direction since holes are coming to this side. So we can write this is EFV or this is EFC. EFC, that is Fermi level for, or we can write is EFN and EFP. After incident of light on this junction, these are the, or we can use some different colors, but which one? Let's say this one. So this is the Fermi level after incident of light. This one. and this difference is equal to minus Q VOC. And one important thing here is that we are not collecting these charge carriers. That is, there is no internal connection between external connection between these two. So this situation is known as open circuit situation or condition. This condition is open circuit condition. So when we are not connecting these two by some external wire, this condition is known as open circuit condition. And now the difference between the Fermi levels of n-type semiconductor and p-type semiconductor is equal to the open circuit voltage into charge of the electron or charge carrier. So here one important thing comes into play, that is VOC or open circuit voltage. That is, in open circuit condition, when the terminals of the solar cell are not connected to each other, and therefore no electric current can flow through an external circuit. At this condition, a voltage difference can be measured between the terminals of the solar cell . This voltage is denoted by open circuit voltage. That is VOC. And this is an important parameter for a solar cell. So here meaning is that this is our absorber layer, and this side is n-type membrane, and this side is p-type membrane, that is A, N, P. We are giving some light to the solar cell, electrons and holes pairs are generated, but we are not connecting these two terminals. So these two terminals are not connected, then we can measure a potential difference between these two, and that potential difference is equal to the open circuit voltage. But when we connect these two terminals, then that condition is known as short circuit condition. That is in short circuit condition, the terminals of the solar cell are connected to each other and a current flows through the external circuit. This current is known as short circuit current, that is denoted by ISC or JSC. Sometime here current density and current have similar meaning. Sometime when we use unit area of the solar cell, then ISC is also the current density. So let me again draw energy band diagram when we short circuit the system. That is, this is EC for n-type material and this is EV. This is EC and this is EV. And there is a energy difference between EV of this absorber and also there is energy difference between the conduction band and of these two absorber, and this is P. So this is N type, this is absorber and this is P type. So here when we, this is EC and this is EV, so let's say this is the formula for this N type and this is the formula for P type. So in this way, we can get electric current. So this is short circuit condition. So in open circuit we can get zero current, but we can measure maximum voltage और मैक्सिमम पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस बिटवीन दिस टर्मिनल्स विच इज नोन एज ओपन सर्किट वोल्टेज एंड इन शॉर्ट सर्किट व्हेन वी कनेक्ट द टर्मिनल्स ऑफ दिस एन टाइप एंड पी टाइप वी कैन गेट मैक्सिमम अमाउंट ऑफ करंट विच इज नोन एज शॉर्ट सर्किट करंट और ISC. सो देर इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टर्म इन सोलर सेल विच इज नोन एज सोलर सेल एफिशियंसी और समटाइम वी कैन ऑल्सो से इट एज कन्वर्जन एफिशियंसी. That is the amount of light that could be converted into electrical energy. So, the solar cell efficiency is calculated as the ratio of or ratio between the generated maximum power and the irradiance value. Normally, this input power or incident power is taken at 1000 watt per meter square at AM 1.5 spectrum. So, simple meaning is here is that the solar cell efficiency, which can be denoted by eta, which is equal to the maximum power that is generated by the solar cell and the incident power in the shape of light or in the form of light energy. And we can also write it as product of ISC into VOC into fill factor by P in, where FF is the fill factor. So this is the solar cell efficiency. So in next lecture, we will see some real example of a solar cell and we'll define some other terms like fill factor and also see the IV characteristic of a solar cell.